All right, let's try to do the same thing with Laplace transform. So our equations were the following. And the system will be this. Is this one. So how do I find the Laplace? How do I find the transfer function, right? We need to find the transfer function. That's how we're going to do the Laplace transform thing. We are going to find input versus output. Isn't that what we learned in system dynamics? Okay, so what's the input here? And what's the output? So I thought we can look at the stability using the transfer function, characteristic equations, and so on and so forth, isn't it? So what's the input? Well, as of now, I don't have an input. I just take it to the initial condition, leave it, and it will come back to this point. I don't have an input. So I have to invent an input so that I can actually look at an input-output relation. So, how do I get the input? Don't do it again, okay? What is the input? There is no input. I have to invent an input. Let me invent an input to the system. Let's say someone is pulling with a force F. So that would be an input. So if I'm in equilibrium and I'm trying to move this from the equilibrium point, there are two ways, right? I mean, if I want to see a motion. One is I start from another initial condition, then it will start moving, or I'm at the initial condition, which is the equilibrium point, and then I push it with a force, and then it will start moving again. So that will be my input, so I can pull it. So I can pull it and leave it here, and then pull back and forth, or whatever. So I'm adding a force. In which equation should I add the force? Onto which equation should I add the force? Theta 2 dot. So you are suggesting I'm doing this. Is that good? That's correct. So this will be actually my theta 2 dot. So where is that coming from? It's coming from this. Remember, it's in the x direction. And if I write the equations of motion for the x direction, then I can add this F force over here. So where is the x direction, the force in the x direction? The equation was somewhere here, minus mg sine theta minus k theta dot plus some f over here. Okay? And this equation corresponds to the equation, corresponds to this equation. So I would just add a force. It will be positive because it's in the positive direction, right? This is where I had x, so it will be in the positive direction. So I will take that as my input. Is that good? So it will be now an input. Now I can look at the Laplace transform and look at the input versus output. So input here, let's take the Laplace transform of this whole thing. It will be s theta 1 of s now. Is equal to theta 2 of s, right? This is the first one because it's a derivative here. S theta 2 of s is equal to minus gl theta 1 of s minus kml theta 2 of s plus f of s. Okay? All right. So let's put this into that equation. We will get s squared theta 1 of s equal to minus g divided by l theta 1 of s minus k divided by ml s theta 1 of s plus f of s. Input versus output, let's do this. S squared plus s k divided by ml plus g divided by l theta 1 of s is equal to f of s. So, output versus input divided by input. This is the transfer function. Equal to 1 divided by s squared plus s k divided by m l plus g divided by l. So if you use the numeric values that we had, I think we used 2 for this one, we said 2 for that and 3 for this, right? That's what we used as an example. So this one will be 1 divided by s squared plus s, 3s, I'm sorry, plus 3s plus 2. Transfer function. Characteristic equation is where? Here. So I would take this one, s squared plus 3s plus 2 is equal to 0. This is what I would call the characteristic equation. So what are the roots of the characteristic equation? S1? Minus 1 and minus 2. You see? What is this equation? It is the equation we found when we were trying to find the eigenvalues. Remember? In fact, the eigenvalues, remember this? Trying to find the eigenvalues, determinant of the A matrix, of eigenvalue of the A matrix, basically determinant with these eigenvalues, and I write the equation. What is the equation? It's this. The equation is the same as the equation of the characteristic equation. Therefore, the eigenvalues are at the same time the roots of the characteristic equation, if it's a linear system, of course. So finding the eigenvalues of the A matrix is equivalent to finding the roots of the characteristic equation if you have a system in this form. And you know what these things mean. You put them into the imaginary, in the complex plane, and minus 1 is here, minus 2 is here, and you immediately say, oh, the equilibrium point is stable. Right? That's what you do in system dynamics. And we did the same thing looking at the eigenvalues. Because when I looked at the eigenvalues were here, the solution. And if the eigenvalues are negative, then everything is good, it is stable. If they are positive, they are unstable. Does that make sense? Okay. Any questions for this? I mean, this was quite straightforward, I guess. Okay. One thing we might want to write as a note then. If the linearized system around the equilibrium point is unstable, if the linearized system, it was linearized around the equilibrium point. It's unstable. Which means not all eigenvalues are negative. Then the equilibrium point of the nonlinear system is also unstable. If the linearized system around the equilibrium point, the linearized system, which means it is linearized around the equilibrium point, is unstable, the equilibrium point of the linear system is unstable, which means not all eigenvalues are on the left-hand plane, then the equilibrium point of the nonlinear system is also unstable. And the opposite is also true. If the linearized system, the equilibrium point of the linear system is a stable equilibrium, then the equilibrium point of the nonlinear system around which it was linearized is also stable. Okay, this is one and this is two. So the nonlinear system might have a number of equilibrium points. Remember, the pendulum has this equilibrium point and it has this equilibrium point. So this one was a stable equilibrium point and this one was an unstable equilibrium point. So when I take the nonlinear system and I linearize it around this equilibrium point, then I will have a linear system which one equilibrium point, which is 0, 0. I look at the stability of that equilibrium point of the linear system. And I can draw the conclusion that this equilibrium point of the nonlinear system is stable or unstable, depending on what comes out. Now, the nonlinear system investigate the stability of this equilibrium point, you have to redo everything I've done. Basically, linearize the dynamic system around the nonlinear dynamic system around this equilibrium point and investigate the stability of the linear system. And depending on this outcome of the investigation of the linear system, you can have a conclusion about the stability of this equilibrium point of the nonlinear system. So an airplane, for instance, might have hundreds of equilibrium points because every velocity, every altitude is another equilibrium point. So you can linearize the airplane's dynamics around each of these equilibrium points and investigate the stability of the equilibrium points of that airplane. Every time you linearize it at a different equilibrium point will give you another linear system. The linear system will change based on this one or this one where you linearize it. And then you look at the A matrix of this linear system. You can look at the linear equilibrium point of this linear system. Every equilibrium, every linear system, this is a linear system. Every linear system has the equilibrium where x is equal to 0. That is your equilibrium because you can see it over here. If x star is equal to 0, then the only solution is that x is equal to 0. Unless A is equal to 0, which means there's no real dynamics. So if A is not 0, right, the matrix is not fully 0, then X must be equal to 0. So X0 is always the equilibrium point for the linear system. So here we had theta 1 is equal to 0, theta 2 is equal to 0. This was the equilibrium point of the nonlinear system. The linear system had also the equilibrium point. And the linear system had also theta 1 is equal to 0 and theta 2 is equal to 0, right? That's nonlinear and that's linear. Now for this one, that will be a little different because theta 1 is 180 degrees, theta 2 is equal to 0 for the nonlinear system. But if you linearize it around 180, you will see that the equilibrium point of the linear system is still 0, 0. Okay. So I will give you this one as a homework. Or if you just want to do it as an exercise, go home and try everything that we have done for this case. Okay? Do it for this case. I give it to you as an homework. I will put it on the website. Okay? The next homework will be doing this. So then you can actually do everything I have done. Do it here again. But there will be a little trick, and I will write it in the homework. It will, there will, you know, mathematically you will have to play around a little bit. Okay, any questions? Is that good enough? If that's good, we'll start the actual course now. I mean, the actual this is kind of the end of our review. Okay? Okay, so let's stop here. This is the end of the review, and what we are going to do next is we are going to do exactly what we have done for the pendulum for an airplane now. All right? So let's start with two things. Remember last time when I wrote the pendulum, when I plotted the pendulum, the first thing I did was I assigned a coordinate system to this thing, right? I put a coordinate system somewhere and say, this is X, this is Y, let's put a coordinate system. And then we had these questions. Everybody asked, okay, I asked about the acceleration of this pendulum in the X direction, Y direction. And someone said, well, this pendulum is not moving with respect to this coordinate system. How can you talk about acceleration? Well, then I talked about observers, the observer. Who's looking at it and who's deciding on the acceleration? Because depending where you look at, the thing will have a different acceleration and different velocity. So motion is relative, right? If I'm sitting in the car, I look at the car will say, I'm not moving. I'm saying the car is not moving. But someone looking from the outside will say, you are both moving. In fact, someone from space will say, the car is rotating as well because the Earth is rotating. So what is my velocity and what is my acceleration? It depends on the observer, right? And we decided that the observer we call a reference frame. It is the reference from where we define motion. And the coordinate system has nothing to do with the reference frame. It is just some axes that we put there to measure directions, magnitudes, and things like this. So let's make it formal and let's define reference frame. Or sometimes we call it frame of reference. Okay, frame of reference. So, what is a frame of reference? How can we define this now? It's the observer from where you are looking at it. Okay? So, for instance, again, let's say you have a car and you're sitting in the car. And there's someone looking outside, looking at this car and saying the car has a certain velocity, blah, blah. If you're sitting inside, you're saying the car has no velocity. You might be outside sitting in space looking at this thing and you might say, you know, the car has a different velocity. Let me give you another strange example. Let's say you are on a little paper airplane. The little paper airplane is moving around. And you are sitting on that little paper airplane and looking at the car. And the car goes up, it goes down. In fact, you are going up and down. But if you're looking from the paper airplane, you might think that the car is going up and down. The whole world is moving around you, right? So in that case, this paper airplane could be a reference frame, isn't it? For example, look at this pen. Look at this pen. I throw it in the air. What did you see? Made a loop, came back, isn't it? You're the observer. If you would be sitting on this pen, what would you see? If you would be sitting on this pen and looking at you, what would you see? You would be saying, oh, the whole class is moving and coming back. Because if you don't know that you are moving, right? So this could be a reference frame. My pen could be a reference frame. You could sit the observer here, look at the class, and say the class is making a turn. Or you could be sitting there in the class and say the pen is making a turn. These are two different reference frames, isn't it? So, what is a reference frame then? How can we define, or what can be a reference frame? Anything can be a reference frame. If you can sit on an object and look at the world from that object, you could be the reference frame and say, okay, this is moving, that is moving, this is a velocity, this is an acceleration. So typically, any rigid body could be a reference frame. Because there could be an observer on that rigid body looking around and say, this is moving in this velocity, this is an acceleration of that velocity or that acceleration. So basically, any rigid body can be a reference frame, because on any rigid body there could be an observer who is looking around in the world, to the world around it. So a reference frame is a rigid body or a set of rigidly connected points that can be used to define or establish velocities, accelerations, etc., basically motion.
Reference frame is a rigid body or a set of rigidly connected points that can be used to define, establish velocities, accelerations, etc. And we are so used to define velocities and accelerations using Earth as the rigid body, saying that Earth is the body and everything we define with respect to Earth. So we look at the car, it has a velocity. We look at the acceleration, we say this is the acceleration. If we are the observer sitting on Earth looking at this thing. But you have to understand that it doesn't have to be Earth. You could be sitting on the sun, if you can, and then look at the Earth and say the car has a velocity in that direction, in a certain direction, but the Earth is also moving. So therefore, the velocity of the car is the velocity of the car with respect to the Earth plus the rotation of the Earth. Now we have a different acceleration, different velocity. The sun can be a reference frame. The Earth can be a reference frame. A paper airplane can be a reference frame. Any rigid body where the observer is looking at around it and talks about velocities and accelerations. Is that clear? Okay, so then, what is a coordinate system? Coordinate systems have nothing to do with the reference frame. Okay? Coordinate system is a measurement device, put this in quotations, it's not really a device, it's just a measurement system, usually attached to a reference frame. So we like to attach it somewhere, but it is nothing but a measurement device, a measurement system. Something where we can define vectors, define magnitudes, directions. And you can put it anywhere you want. And that was a... We have a coordinate system that is attached to the ball, I mean to the pendulum. And with respect to this pendulum, the pendulum is not moving. So with respect to this coordinate system, the pendulum is not moving. However, with an observer from the outside, the pendulum is moving. And it is moving with a certain velocity. And in fact, I can, from that observer, I can actually now define velocities. and angles and things like this, motion, accelerations. But it is with respect to this guy. How do I express it? I express it in this coordinate system. I could have put the coordinate system over here. Doesn't matter. This could have been another coordinate system. I could still write this green vector in this coordinate system. The green vector would still be the velocity with respect to this person. So the velocity of this pendulum has one velocity with respect to one observer. And that vector, I can express it in any coordinate system I want. I can put a coordinate system over here and express this velocity vector in this coordinate system, or in this coordinate system, or in that coordinate system. There's one velocity with respect to this guy, though. The velocity with respect to a guy sitting on this pendulum is, of course, zero, because the velocity of the pendulum with respect to the pendulum is zero. If you look at the pendulum, you will say the pendulum is not moving, right? So what I'm trying to say is that velocities and accelerations are with respect to an observer. It can be outside, inside, somewhere on the moon, doesn't matter. That's the reference frame. That velocity vector is one velocity vector, or one acceleration vector. And that can be expressed in any coordinate system you want. You can put the coordinate system here, you can put it here, you can put it here, doesn't matter. The velocity of that ball with respect to this observer, there's one velocity. Understand? Coordinate system, reference frames, totally different things. Totally different. Is that good? Okay. So, having said all this, we usually want to be very clear about who is the observer and in which coordinate system are we writing it. For instance, in the following classes, in the next weeks, whenever I ask or talk about a velocity of an airplane, I need two informations from you. One is, with respect to who is that velocity? Secondly, in which coordinate system do you write that equation, that velocity? Okay, two different things. So we need to always define the reference frame and the coordinate system it is written at. Right? So if I have an airplane, and you say it has a velocity vector that looks something like this, and the velocity vector is equal to, 3, 5, 6 meters per second. I'm just making this up now. You need to tell me what's the coordinate system, x, y, z. Okay, what is the coordinate system? Secondly, with respect to who is this velocity? Is it with respect to ground? Is it the inertial? Is it someone sitting on the moon, someone on the airplane? You need to tell me this. You need to tell me two information, always. Reference frame and coordinate system. Don't tell me a velocity without defining the coordinate system or the reference frame, because they will be different. We need to be very clear with respect to who that velocity or acceleration is and in which coordinate system it is written. And this is the goal for the next month or so, or at least a few weeks, where we are going to define these things very clearly. Okay? Now, next thing we are going to do is we are going to look at reference frames and coordinate systems often used in flight mechanics. So the next topic is reference frames and coordinate systems used in flight mechanics. So if you are talking about airplanes, we have a few coordinate systems that we are using very often in flight mechanics and that we need to know very well in this class. So the first one is what we call the body fixed reference frame, and we attach a body fixed coordinate system along with the reference frame. And that
reference frame we usually define with something called FB. That is this reference frame. So what does it mean? Let me just try to explain you. If we have an airplane, so this is, I guess, the first airplane I'm plotting in this class. Okay, from the side, the airplane usually has, of course, a center of gravity. Not usually, it always has a center of gravity. And the coordinate system that I'm talking about is this one. ZB pointing downwards, XB pointing towards the nose of the airplane, and YB towards the side of the airplane. Okay? So it is a coordinate system that is attached to the airplane. CG is center of gravity. Okay? Center of gravity. XB is pointing towards the nose of the airplane. Nose of the aircraft, let's say. Okay. And the rest, YB and ZB, are completed such that you have a right-handed coordinate system. ZB is in the symmetry axis of aircraft and points downwards. Center or origin of coordinate system is at the CG of the aircraft. So I have a number of things, okay? XB is pointing towards the nose, YB, ZB are completed such that it's a right-handed coordinate system, ZB is in the symmetric axis of the aircraft, the origin of the coordinate system is at the CG of the airplane. Sorry. Okay. You might want to add one more thing. The coordinate system is attached to the airplane moves, rotates with the aircraft. Coordinate system is attached to the aircraft and moves and rotates with it. And this is what we call a body-fixed coordinate system or a body-fixed reference frame. Okay? So if you look at it, it is the most obvious coordinate system. It's the most obvious coordinate system. It is a coordinate system that is attached to the airplane. The center of the origin, the origin of the coordinate system is attached to the CG of the aircraft. The coordinate system rotates and moves with the airplane, just like the coordinate system we had on the pendulum. We call it the body-fixed coordinate system. It is fixed to the body, moves with the body. XB is pointing towards the north, towards the nose. ZB down and YB is to the side. And they have to form a right-handed coordinate system. You know how to form a right-handed coordinate system, right? Here's how you do it. You take your right hand, you move your four fingers from X to Y. From X to Y. Your thumb has to show the Z-axis. Okay? So, I plot X and Y, I take my four fingers, rotate from X to Y, your thumb should be pointing the Z direction. Then it is a right-handed coordinate system. If you plot X like this, Y like this, and Z upwards, that is not a right-handed coordinate system. Okay, take your four fingers from X to Y, point Z. Sounds simple, but we are going to write a lot of coordinate systems. Every coordinate system in this class must be a right-handed coordinate system, otherwise everything we develop from here will break down. They will not be valid anymore. So every time you plot a coordinate system somewhere in this class, make sure it's a right-handed coordinate system. Okay? Sounds simple, but I see in exams a lot of students trying to find the right direction of the coordinate systems. It's simple. So never forget, take your right hand, four fingers, go from X to Y, the thumb should be pointing in the Z direction. Okay? That's a right-handed coordinate system. All right? Good. So, body fixed reference frame, what does that mean? It is, any rigid body can be a reference frame, so therefore, the observer sits on that airplane. Okay? Good. So, here's my question. What is the velocity of the aircraft with respect to the body fixed reference frame? Zero. Right? You sit on an airplane, look at the airplane, airplane is not moving. What is the velocity of the Earth with respect to the body fixed reference frame? Whatever is it, you look downwards, the Earth is moving this way, it's going backwards. So that's the velocity of the Earth with respect to the airplane, with respect to the body fixed reference frame. The airplane, let's say, flies straight on this line, okay, with a velocity of 800 kilometers per hour. So looking from the ground, I see the airplane going in a straight line, 800 kilometers per hour. So the velocity of the airplane with respect to someone looking from the Earth is 800 kilometers per hour. So it might look like this. Airplane, X body, Z body, and Y body. This is ground. That's me. Looking at the airplane. And I see that the airplane is moving with 800 kilometers per hour in this direction. It has a constant velocity, 800 kilometers per hour. Okay? Good. This is the velocity of someone looking from the ground moving this way. Can I write this velocity vector in this coordinate system? Yes, of course, I can write it like this. I can decompose it into these two vectors. So this will be in the x direction, this will be in the y direction, let's call this x, and this one z, and this one some other vector, y, and then you can say v is equal to x, y, z. So I can write this velocity vector that I see from the ground in this coordinate system. It does not mean it is the velocity of that airplane with respect to that coordinate system. The reference frame is Earth or the sky, whatever. And I can rewrite this vector in this coordinate system. So two different things. Understood? Good. So this is body fixed coordinate system. Any questions?
Sir,
yes?
I'm not sure that why we always should be the
Y B? Yeah, it could be on the other side as well.
Okay.
If it's to the other side, in which direction will be ZB? Upwards. Okay. In flight mechanics, this is what we call body fixed coordinate system.
So I cannot change. It should be.
You could, but when in flight mechanics, when I talk about the body fixed coordinate system, this is the one that I will mean in this class, and most of the time in flight mechanics, unless otherwise defined, this is what we mean by body fixed coordinate system. Okay? So in flight mechanics, if someone talks about body fixed coordinate system, this is the one we are talking about. Okay? Any questions? I have at least three or four more coordinate systems that I will define next week. The next one is a little bit, it's not as straightforward. You have to think a little bit. I want you to be fresh when you think about it. So if you don't have any questions, see you next week. All right.